We weathered the storm? Everyone looks weathered. I mean, like, you weathered the storm? Ah, I guess I shouldn't tell jokes first thing this morning. Well, I want to welcome everyone. Welcome to some of our visitors. This is a very special Sunday. We're going to have Testimony Sunday. But as we begin today, we're going to give our own testimony. We're all going to sing, "There's No God Like Jehovah." Do you believe that today? Amen. There's no God like Jehovah? So put on your singing voices and let's praise Jesus as we enter in today. Why don't you stand and sing? Made. So we want to rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we know that sometimes we go through difficulties and trials. We recognize that even today, some folks are dealing with the impacts of a storm. But thank you that we have been able to come to this place to gather in your name, and we are here to worship you. We are here to give honor and worship and praise and glory and majesty and power unto our King. For you are good, and we praise you today. Thank you that you have brought this crowd here today, these folks, and I pray a blessing for each and every one as we enter into Testimony Sunday. I pray that we will be impacted and that we will encounter the living God in a real way in this place. And Father, I pray for everyone watching online that even though they're not physically present with us, that the Holy Spirit of God would knit our hearts as one, and that everyone listening, everyone here, everyone at home, would be blessed in the name of Jesus, our Savior today. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to do things just a little bit different order today for this week. And so a couple of announcements as we begin this Tuesday. The prayer shawl group is beginning again at Gloria's home. So if you're not sure what the prayer shawl group is, it's a group of ladies who sew and knit and make things and teach those of us who don't know how, and usually give them out to bless others. The prayer shawls have been shared kind of far and wide. So if you are of that desire, then you can start with Gloria's team this week at 1 o'clock. Next Sunday, we have Naomi and Ruth coming. Has anyone heard of Naomi and Ruth? I think it's Verna. She is organizing next Sunday. Naomi and Ruth is an outreach for addicted females. And so this is our first time having them to our church. We've done Teen Challenge, which works primarily with men. But Naomi and Ruth are coming next week, so be prepared. They're going to share their stories. They're going to share a little bit with us next Sunday while the pastors are at Pastor's Retreat in Moncton. And there will be a special offering, so just be prepared for that. We want to bless them as they come. And then next Sunday night, Carol and I think Clyde and Lynn are going to lead in a hymn sing. So it'll be a special time of him singing the old hymns and testimonies next Sunday evening. So lots of good stuff coming up next week. And now I'm going to ask the missions team to come. It's Alabaster Sunday today, and they have a little something special for us. Somebody from it. There we go.
Many of you are well aware of what alabaster is and when we collect it and what we do with it and all that kind of thing. But the council is aware that we have a lot of newer people that have come in the last little while. So we thought we'd just like to give you a little refresher on where the idea of alabaster offering came from and where it goes. So you have to lose your imaginations a little bit later too. In 1945, the world was recovering from World War II and money was very scarce. At that year's meeting of the Global Council of the Women's Foreign Missionary Society, which is now Nazarene Missions International, Elizabeth Venom, who was a member of that council, was challenged to come up with an idea or plan that would increase the church's giving to missions. So on her way home from that council meeting, she was praying fervently to God for what would be his plan. What idea would he want them to do? And God directed her thoughts to a portion of scripture. It's actually found in all four of the Gospels, but I'm going to read you Matthew chapter 26, verses 6 to 13. And like I said, you use your imagination. While Jesus was in Bethany, in the home of a man known as Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, which she poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. When the disciples saw this, they were indignant. "Why this waste?" they asked. "This perfume could have been sold at a high price and the money given to the poor." Aware of what they were thinking, Jesus said to them, "Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me. When she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. I tell you the truth, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." So as Elizabeth thought about this scripture and about the selfless gift that this woman had poured out on Jesus, she came up with an idea of an alabaster offering that would challenge the people to give up a want to meet a need. The Board of General Superintendents approved her plan for these funds, and they decided that they should be used for buildings and properties on the mission fields. So today and next week, as we bring our offerings for alabaster, we are collecting with our whole denomination around the world. They collect usually twice a year in September and February, and 100% of all the funds that come in for the alabaster offering are used for buildings and properties on the mission fields. This could be houses for pastors, it could be churches, could be schools, could be hospitals, whatever the need is, it is met by our alabaster giving. So we can be part of God's team around the world, like this little bit that we bring in as we bring our coins or our dollar bills or whatever we bring. So I will ask you today, as if you have brought your alabaster offering, as our offering is collected, you can just come up and deposit them in either one of these two big alabaster boxes or the church in the center, wherever you'd like, and that money will be collected and counted and passed on to the people who need it.
Good morning. Yes, that's right. Yes, I, before we receive the offering, I just want to draw your attention to the WEF Thanksgiving display here. We do have two items over there. So that means there is over $400 in for Thanksgiving offering WEF. Okay, if I could have the ushers. Shall we pray? Our gracious Father, we come into this place, gather in thy name, and bring and offer praise and adoration unto thee. Father, we thank you for all that you have bestowed and done in our lives, Lord. And Father, we just bring the worship unto you at this time. And Father, we would now worship you with our tithes and our offerings and the gifts that you have bestowed upon us. We pray, Father, that you would bless gift and giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
the worship team. I think you guys are good now. I'm going to just give a little introduction kind of to what we're doing and then pray before we invite our first testimony. I felt kind of impressed to share, and just in case you're thinking that we forgot to send the kids down, they're staying for one of the stories, so they're here for a little bit longer. So I felt impressed a little bit ago that we should do a testimony Sunday. A lot of times we do testimonies during hymn nights and we kind of share, but we don't often get to hear the stories. And sometimes when you're listening, the Spirit will speak through multiple people and you got to kind of catch it. And it came to me through different conversations. You know, we need to tell stories. Clyde and I had a conversation, Marla and I, and the Lord and I, and so I thought, you know what, let's just do a full-on testimony Sunday, and I asked the Lord who should share, and we have Courtney and Phil and my friend Tracy's coming from Halifax to share with us today, too. But just as before we begin, I wanted to kind of remind us a little bit about the story of the Samaritan woman. Now, for many of you, the story is familiar, maybe not to everyone. But in this story, Jesus was resting by Jacob's well, and a woman comes to gather water. And they have this interesting interaction. When he asked her for water, she's kind of, you know, gave a, what are you talking about? I'm a Samaritan, and you're a Jew, and we don't talk, and, you know, you're a man, and I'm a woman. But then they have this interesting little conversation. You can read about it in John chapter 4. But at the end of it, after he says, if you knew who was talking to you, you'd ask me, him, and he would give you living water. And in the end, she said, well, we're waiting for the Messiah. And he said, it's me. I am the Messiah. I am he. I'm the one that you're speaking of. And so she goes back after this encounter. But I wanted to point out the part of the story that we don't often maybe focus on, because a lot of the time we talk about that encounter. But when she went home and told her story, John 4, verse 39, listen to how it popped out as I pondered it this week. It said, many, say that with me, many, not just a few, many of the Samaritans from the town believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. Bam, I liked that. Many believed in Jesus because of this woman's testimony. Our testimonies have power. In Revelation 12:11, it says that they would overcome the enemy, the accuser, Satan, through what? The blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Jesus has shed his blood. That work is done, friends. And now, what do we have? Our testimony, our story. So I'm going to invite Courtney to come and kick us off today, and she's going to share a little bit of her story.
Can everyone hear me okay? Good morning. Jody asked me to share with you how I've come into my faith in God this morning. When she first asked me, I was nervous, and I still am a little nervous. However, I think we should all put ourselves in situations that scare us sometimes. It's how we come to know what we're truly made of. My initial journey with the Lord started as a child, probably similar to a lot of people, going to Sunday school with family. I do regret to say the only things I can really remember is the story of Jesus' birthday at Christmas and Mary and Joseph. Life got busy. As a teenager, I could still feel something calling me to the church. I started to go on my own to this church with my childhood babysitter, that some may know, June Longshaw. I always felt safe here. Again, life got busy. I was a teenager. Distractions got the best of me. I went here and there into adulthood, mostly if someone asked me to go, I would never say no, but I was in no way faithful to my Lord. It is still hard for me to get all of this into words, but I'm going to try my best. I'm now 36 years old. If I were to face God today, I would definitely have things to answer for. I have put other things over God. I have felt I had the power to control my own life. I have given into fear and struggled with anxiety. I'm sure I've told a lie or two, and the list could go on. In my life so far, I've experienced two life-changing experiences, death and divorce. All of my experiences have led me to the only solid truth I know, and that is that I serve my God. The death I experienced was a huge loss to my family. The sudden passing of my father, who brought a lot of joy to our lives, was the first time I really looked at my life and realized I wasn't living a happy life. The aftermath of that loss led me to my next life-changing experience of divorce. I have heard in some of the preachings the experiences of death and divorce that they can be comparable. As someone who has experienced both, I feel this is the truth. It's a grief that can truly shake you to your core. There's a lot of anger, sadness, resentment, a lot of lessons, and it doesn't go away quickly. Throughout both experiences, people would tell me how strong I am. When these experiences were happening to me and people were telling me how strong I was, I couldn't understand that. What does it even mean to tell someone they're strong? Why are these things even happening to me? I don't really want to be strong. The death left me without a father, my mother without a husband, a breakdown of my marriage, and now I'm a single mother of two children. If this is strong, I wasn't quite convinced this was a good thing. About this time last year, I woke up in the night and all I heard was a clear voice telling me I needed to go back to church. I can't say the voice scared me, but it spoke to me in a way I knew I had to listen. Since listening to that voice, my life has been changed. It first started with my anxiety. I quickly came to realize I wasn't putting my trust into God. I was having fears because I wanted to control the outcomes of my life. A simple example of this is my son was playing basketball and his jersey went missing. It soon had to be returned and I was going to have to pay $75. We couldn't find the jersey anywhere. I prayed for the mystery of the jersey to show up, as none of us could understand how it quickly disappeared. I put my trust in God that either way, I mean, it would be okay. $75. The day before the $75 was due, I received notice the jersey had been taken by another child by mistake, and the mystery was solved. This is a very light-natured example, but it just really did open my eyes to the worry, fear, the anxiety over things we really can't control. I enjoy riding my mountain bike in the woods near my house. My challenge this summer was a large hill. I found if I looked at the top of the hill, it was harder for me to reach the top compared to focusing on my feet. If I focused on each pedal I took, I reached the top much easier. This led me to realize when I'm walking my path in life, I have to focus on where I'm at and trust in God the right path is laid out for me and that it will be okay and I will always end up where I need to be and when that's meant for me to get there. I have also watched the ways my children have a relationship with God change things for them. I will hear my children correct adults when they say the Lord's name in vain. I find this very brave because some people have a hard time standing up for the right thing. They enjoy learning at Sunday school. They enjoy sharing a nighttime prayer. One of my sons is afraid of the dark. When he is scared, I tell him to pray to God, to ask him to please take this from me. I can't handle this burden right now, and I trust you. I ask him to say this to God and then to believe what he says, and it really works for him. I use this same prayer if I can feel anxiety coming on. I do trust God, and it does work. He is looking out for me. I have never felt more myself since opening up my calling to have a relationship with God. It has changed my whole perspective on life in ways that my main goal is to have a happy life, a peaceful life. As I mentioned, I have had to hold some hard experiences. I see now we are never given anything in life we can't handle, and that life is hard. The world has a lot of evil in it, and I know my hard times are not over. My trust in God is not perfect. My fear of God is not perfect. I can see myself every day in any of my problems building on these relationships with God. Instead of staying in the place of fear and focusing on that, I find my mind switching to prayer and I remain peaceful. We are given one for sure outcome in life, and that is death. I want to make sure I do live in the fear of God and I trust in God. I will be given the life that was laid out for me. I believe I have a lot of life to live and I feel very excited about life. After answering this calling from God, I feel there is a lot in life I will be prepared to do. Being strong has brought a whole new meaning to me. I am also, from all of my experience, able to be a person of true compassion, empathy, and understanding to a lot of people in the world. One of my sons told me one day that he thinks I am love. When Jody asked me to share in some of my experiences, I couldn't stop hearing 1 Corinthians in my head. I am not experienced in scripture. It is something I do ask God for, to help me understand. When I read 1 Corinthians, I understood the message that Paul was attempting to restore the Corinthian church to its foundation, Jesus Christ. I feel I am in the process of restoring myself back to my foundation, Jesus Christ, and I want to live in love, wisdom, all good things, with discernment, and not to live in a place of fear that causes anger, anxiety, and resentment. I want to live in a place of trust for God and peace, and I believe I will send 2 children into the world with the same foundation, Jesus Christ. So in a closing remark, I was working on this yesterday, and my youngest son, who is a really fussy eater, who refuses to eat a lot of food, was watching me write in my notepad, and he asked me if I had to read all of these words. I said yes. Jody asked me to speak for 10 minutes, 10 minutes in front of everyone, and I am a little nervous. But I do think it's good for mom to do things that scare her, so the more I do it, the less scary it will be. The next thing he said to me was, I think tomorrow I will try salad. So I think this is, I think it's all pretty awesome. Thank you.
I love that ending. That was so good, Courtney. Thank you. Many of you remember Courtney was baptized with her oldest at Big Lake Camp this summer, and she joined the church this year. And man, I can tell you that it just blessed my heart. When we had our meeting where we talked a little bit about church membership, I remember Courtney just saying, okay, like I'm there. I want to move forward. I want to step into this. And I thought, wow. You know, and it reminded me when she started telling me about June taking her to Sunday school and stuff, how many of us could say we have a similar story where we were introduced to Jesus at a young age, but we sort of went our own way. Who would have a story like that? For a while, we went our own way for a little while. That was my story for a short time. But you know, I chose this song because no matter how much we run, Jesus never lets go. Loving on us, chasing after us, waiting for the day that will come. He's ready to embrace us. So why don't you stand and we're going to sing that together. Reckless Love.
Jesus, me down.
we thank you that you love us in such a way that no mountain will stand between us and you, no lie, no power of the enemy, no distance, no way that we run away. Nothing can keep us from the love of God. We thank you, Father, that you are waiting and calling and extending your grace to people today. Here in this room, maybe watching at home, they have run away from you for a time. I pray that even as Courtney shared her heart today, that their spirit would be quickened by the work of your Holy Spirit working through her words to awaken them to come home, to come back to the Father, to return to the one who loved them and made them and has a plan for their lives. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that no power, no lie, no fear, nothing would keep us. Everyone listening today, nothing would keep them from the love of God expressed in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You are the only way to salvation. And I pray today that even this day, one would come home and experience life in Jesus' name. Thank you that you never give up on us when we go running in the other direction. Thank you, Jesus, that you never gave up on me. Thank you for your mercy today. We thank you, God, as a people, as a church, we thank you for your mercy and your grace and your goodness. That, Jesus, you were willing to die so that we could live. And, oh, Lord, we take that sacrifice lightly. Help us, Father, today. Help us to see and know the truth that you love us today. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Not life, not death, not angels, not demons, not anything now or anything to come. Nothing can separate us from your love. Thank you for the love of God. We celebrate today and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, Courtney, again for sharing your testimony. It is amazing to see what God is doing in his people. Now, before we call Phil up, we're going to let the worship team go and the kids go with Miss Nicole. So if you're in grade 1 to grade 6, you get to head on down with our kids ministry team and have some fun downstairs. And isn't it cool? We have a little group of teenagers sitting over there. We're calling it the teen seats. We're wanting to, you know, have the children aspire to the day. Steve is still trying to stay, you know, in the teen seats, but yeah, they push you out. Tyler still gets to be in the teen seats, but okay, awesome. We're so thankful for all those that are working in our children's ministry, and it's such a blessing. But now it's time for Phil to come. So Phil, why don't you come and share a little bit about your story? Many of you know that Phil and Agatha came a year-ish ago from Brazil, and they've joined the church. They're part of our family, and we've had many interesting conversations. I don't know if he's going to get into their love story, but if he doesn't tell that, ooh, it's good. You should hear that one. But their story is, Phil is just an incredible, incredible heart, and I'm so thankful. Now, remember, English isn't his first language, so this is a big deal to be able to come and stand up in front of people. So know that we're with you. We love you. Share with us, Phil.
Well, thank you, Jody, for challenging me and for inviting me. So it's a pleasure to be here today. Indeed, this is my first time talking in front of a lot of people, so I would like to start with a prayer first, with a prayer. So I ask you to close your eyes for a few seconds, please. Holy Spirit of God, I thank you for everything. It's not about me. This testimony is not about my life. It's about your wonderful works in me, in us. So thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for your salvation. Thank you for give your life to me and your life for us. So thank you so much. I I'm really thankful for everything. So I ask you, please guide me, Holy Spirit of God. In Jesus' name, amen. So yes, as Jody said, English is not my first language. I'm from Brazil, so it's not Spanish too, it's Portuguese. But yes, well, I will start my testimony like a lot of people over here. I was raised in a church. My father, he was pastor. And I had great experience with God when I was a child. So I remember usually in the weekends I was with my father and his friends going to camp. And I had a really great times with God, a great experience with the Holy Spirit. And I need to say something first. Am I nervous? Yes, I am. But my heart is burning to share this with you. Amen. So, I was growing up. And then when I turned it 14 years, I decided to don't go anymore to the church. So I asked my mom, please, I don't need to go to the church anymore. Because I think people go into the church, usually they need something, and I have everything, so I'm okay. I'm totally okay. I really don't need to go. So, yeah, I will stay home all the nights now. I don't need to go to the services on Sundays. And, this was the worst decision in my life. I know that. Today I know. So, and I know today I'm totally different guy. I'm look like a nerd, probably. I'm father, I'm husband, but trust me, I was the worst one when I was 14, when I was 15, and then, anyways, I decided to live a terrible life when I was a teenager, and then, every weekend, so I was going to some parties with my friends. I was doing terrible things. I was drinking a lot. I was terrible. I was doing very terrible in my high school. So what was a crazy life? I was living a crazy life, like a fool guy. And, So I was really diving very deep in the devil's lies because my brother, for example, he got married and 1 year and 6 months later, he got divorced. And my sister, she went in the same way. After 1 year, she got divorced too. And for me, I didn't believe in family. I was not planning to make a family. No, I was just living like a crazy person every day, anyways, doing bad things. And then I remember it was in 2018. I decided to travel with some friends. We went to another province in northwest of Brazil. This travel was like just for 1 week, I think, but every night, a lot of parties, drinking a lot, using drugs, and doing bad things every day. And the last day, I remember, I was in front of the sea. I was in a beach, so I was a little high at that time, but suddenly, something happened, and I was okay. I was not too high. I mean, how can I say that? Yeah, I'm just finding the the appropriate word. But anyways, I was very sad that day, and I was thinking about my life. And I remember when I was a child, sometimes I had some visions about angels and demons too, but much more angels, thank God for that. But when I was living this part of my life, I was not seeing nothing anymore. Like, I had no visions, I was not praying, I was not listening to God. So I was just living my life, just living my ways. It was my choice. So that day I was in front of the sea, just watching the waves and thinking about my life. And suddenly I saw the sky opened, and I saw a lot of demons pushing people to do bad things, to sin against God. And for me it was like a shock in the first time, and I thought, oh no, probably I'm too high now, so okay, this is not happening, this is not real, probably it's just my imagination. And then I decided just walk a little bit, take some air, and suddenly appeared a person in the party, and this person told me, hey, you need to come back to God, because the devil is trying to kill you, and that's true. And for me, it was like, oh, okay, thanks for telling me that, but okay. I decided to go to my hotel and just to rest a little bit, and I thought, oh, I don't know, I need to think about my life. I was living very sad every day. I was not good, really. And after that, 1 week later, I was going back to my city. And I remember I was in the plane and crying and asked God to, you know, give me another chance. I was pretty sad. And when I came back, probably 3 or 4 days later, I was going to the parties with my buddies again, and I was like, oh, come on, guys, let's have a fun. I forgot everything that was happened with me that day. And but I was still living empty. And I know that I was so far from the God's way. And I remember a day I was in my car, very sad, do you know? So there was no reason to leave that time. And suddenly a voice started in my mind. So, hey, you are nobody. Nobody cares about you. You are not planning to leave. You are not planning to make a family. So why you don't kill yourself? Why you don't just speed your car and hit in some building and in some, building and finish your life, end your life? Is this the way for you right now? And I was so sad. And I decided to do that. I decided just to speed up my car and finish my life. And I was doing that. I was speeding up the car. And suddenly the car stopped. I was speeding, and the car was not working and just stopped. And I hear the voice, hey, Philip, what are you doing? This is not my plan for your life. This is not my plan for you. I have a future for you. I have everything. This is not my plan for you. What are you doing? And I was so, oh my goodness, I was so sad. And I asked, Jesus, please give me another chance. I will give you my life. I promise I will change. I remember sometimes I was in some nights with my friends, and I could see God protecting me. I was in trouble sometimes. And I remember when I got back to my home, my father was praying for me. My mother, she was praying for me. And I know today my father. He passed away 2 years ago, but I know his prayers is in front of God every day. I'm an answer from his prayers. So Yes, I know. I'm alive today because God gave me another chance, because I had parents praying for me every day. So I would like to finish my testimony. But first of all, I have to advise parents, don't give up. Pray for your children. Pray for your family. And the young fellas, the best and the only choice is Jesus. Believe me, trust me. It's just Jesus. Don't believe in the devil's lies. Amen. And just to finish, there's a verse. This is very important to me. In Psalms 37:5 says, commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him and He will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. That's it. Thank you for your time, guys. God bless you.
Wow. Aren't you blessed by their stories today? I just sense as I was listening to Phil, man, I think we should take a moment and pray for families. Pray for moms and dads. I remember Mark and my Pastor Mark, our DS, your former pastor. I remember him talking to me when I was in my years of rebellion and coming back about Mrs. C and how she would be in the prayer closet praying for him and Walter, you know, talking about Annie, praying for them whenever they were out doing crazy things. I know that there was times that my brother and I, we were raised by godly mom and dad who taught us right, and there's times where I can look back like Phil, and God has given me a vision of where He stood in with angels to keep me alive by His grace that I would be here today. Moms and dads, pray for your kids and for your grandkids, because you might not see it. Maybe God will give them a dream, a glimpse like He gave Phil or He gave me, but you may never see it or know it, but it's life and death in eternity. Let's pray. Let's pause for a minute and pray for our kids and our families. Father, again, we are amazed at your incredible love. I'm just amazed at your grace. I think of my own life when I was running away. You never let me go. I thank you that you never let Phil go. There's no person here today, no one listening today, that has went so far that God is not calling them home. Thank you, Jesus, that every one of us can be made new and adopted and saved and given an eternal hope in heaven simply by turning and accepting by faith the work of Christ. Thank you that you never let us go so far. Father, I want to pray right now for moms and dads, that you would awaken this church, these parents, these mothers and fathers, to the power of prayer. That they would not be, what is the word? That they wouldn't be indifferent or too busy or take it for granted. That the life of their child or their grandchildren are held in the power of their prayer. The scripture tells us that the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective, the fervent prayer. Call us as moms and dads and grandparents to pray for our children. Call forth workers in this church that we would serve and bless and teach our children the ways of Jesus. So even if they step away for a time, like Courtney, like Phil, like so many others, they would be called back. We thank you that your word says, train them up in the way they should go, and when they're old, they will not depart. The truth will be inside them. Father, help us to teach them, help us to pray for them, and Father, bless moms and dads today with a new mantle a prayer mantle that you're putting on them right now, that they need to get back on their knees in that place of prayer and in the Word to pray for their children. Eternity is in the balance. This is the time that we need to turn back to prayer. Father, forgive us for our prayerlessness, for our indifference, for our apathy, that we have an audience with the Almighty God and we take it for granted sometimes. Awaken us to the power of prayer. Thank you, God, that you are so, so, so good to us. You never let us go. You are so, so good. You are faithful, God. We praise your name forever. We praise your name forever.
Never.
Amen. Don't you just sense the presence of God? I just feel so thankful that God pursues us. There seems to be a thread that he's been, you know, tying in the service together today. But I want to invite Tracey now to come. We have one more testimony today. Tracy's going to share a little bit as God laid it on her heart. You know, have you ever met somebody and you thought, this is a great, I'm going to bless this person's life. And it turns out that you do all the receiving and not much of the giving. That's my friendship with Tracey. Come on up, Tracey. We met through our digital church online, and we've talked a little bit. And I will tell you, she has such a prophetic gifting, and God has blessed her. And there's usually hardly a day that goes by that the Lord doesn't speak to me through my sister. And she has been on our Talking with Tanya, so if you missed that podcast, you'll want to check it out. She's led me to a passion of her heart, a guy that does work on identity, and man, so rich. So I've asked her to come from Dartmouth today. She's like everyone else, probably like, oh dear, you know, but we just bless you. Thank you for all that you do to encourage me so I can encourage them and share as the Lord leads you.
Thank you, oh gosh. Hi, everybody. Can I move this down a little bit? Thank you. Gosh, what an honor to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Michael and I, my husband, were just looking at what a beautiful representation of God's people here. Like so many ages and cultures and just all of it. It's just so beautiful to see that. I think I want to pray before I start too. Lord, I thank you for how you design your body. It's so beautiful and majestic and intricate. Thank you for every person and every heart sitting here today, Lord. Holy Spirit, I pray that as I share my story, which is your story, still unfolding, that you would guide me. Lord, I yield my tongue, my heart to you, and I pray that you would lead me in how you would like me to share. And I pray for every heart, whether before me or online, Lord, that it would land on good soil and that fruit would come from it. But most importantly, Lord, I pray for an encounter with every heart, with your very presence, in Jesus' name. It's nerve-wracking being up. Okay, so I think I'll start off my story with you up there. my mom and dad became Christians when I was about in grade 3, so my earliest memories of being introduced to God were around that time. They became born-again believers just in DeBert. They were stationed. My dad was in the Air Force. We were stationed there. And so I feel like there was this ignition season where I remember us being really connected to the church. And then after that, he got posted out west in Alberta. And we just really didn't have the Lord in our lives. Like we really, if I'm looking at it, we really were kind of a snapshot of Easter and Christmas Christians. So I didn't have necessarily an example of the Holy Spirit in my day-to-day. And I think, because I love my mom and dad so much, and they did the best they could, but what I see now with God's wisdom is that after they became born again, they really missed a season of becoming healed. Like there's a season, I think, that after Jesus encounters us and we give our life to him, that he wants us to enter into a season of heart healing and and soul healing and even deliverance in different kinds, in different measures. And I think if we miss that, whether it's just because it's not taught to us or we don't know any better, then we just miss this real, we miss the freedom that he paid for. He doesn't want us to walk in anything but the complete abundance that he paid for. Like he gave everything. There's no lack in his kingdom. So bearing that in mind, I grew up in a family that, like I said, was Easter and Christmas Christians. And when I was a young girl, around 11 or 12, my parents tell me there was a summer that they really noticed that I changed. Like there was a shift in me. And what happened to me personally was that I started hearing all these voices speaking to me. Not good voices. Voices that called me worthless and stupid and ugly and unlovable and separate, not good enough. Just terrible, terrible things. And I didn't know at that time, of course, I didn't know that, you know, the Lord speaks to you, but the enemy does as well. So I didn't know that I could fight back. I didn't have tools to fight back. And I hadn't really given my life to him at that point either. So what happened was I started listening to those voices unknowingly and agreeing with them. You know, it's the power of agreement that gives the enemy a hold on us. He's a legalist. And so if we don't know that when he's speaking to us and placing a false identity on us, that we can say, no, you're a liar. You're the father of lies. And that is not who I am. That's not who God called me to be. But when you don't know that, and you don't even know that it's not yourself, and you come into agreement with it, well, those things carry fruit, not good fruit. So for me personally, that looked like eating disorders and depression and anxiety and fear and cutting myself at an early age. And I didn't have words for it. So it was like I was imploding on the inside. Even during that time when I was growing up, there wasn't an awareness on mental health like there is now. So there wasn't even words like for me to say, I'm in trouble, I need help. Because the enemy led me to believe it's just you, no one else is like this. He has a real ability to isolate us and say, no one else is going through this, only you, right? So what happened to me was, again, those things became strongholds in my life, and I couldn't see outside of them. So my life unfolded in such a way that it was self-sabotaging and pain and isolation, and I grew up trying to white-knuckle everything, trying to hold it together. Didn't do a very good job of that. I got married when I was, my first marriage after my husband Michael, I got married when I was 24, and because I hadn't encountered the Lord and I was completely broken, I attracted that same brokenness to me, a same man who was broken needing the Lord. So unfortunately, that was a marriage that was incredibly abusive on every level. And the pain that unfolded because of that led me to a place of struggling with addiction. It gave birth to it in that, because I would reach for alcohol and suddenly the pain would go away and I would feel like, okay, I can catch my breath. So it was introduced to me at that point in time, and it wasn't long after being married for about 4 years that I had a complete nervous breakdown. Tried to kill myself, was in the hospital. My children were taken away from me for a time. And I just lost everything. But even looking back at that time, the Lord swept in and helped me to keep going. Because, I don't know, I think a lot of faces probably deal with anxiety and depression. And for me as a mom, when my kids were taken out of the picture for a season, I couldn't fight for myself, but I could fight for them. So he positioned even something really bad, you know, used for good, because it helped me keep going. So, and I did, and I got them home, and we restarted, and we started to build our life back. And there were places in me that got healed, but I still hadn't met Jesus yet. I still hadn't. And then I met my husband, Michael. And I met him when I was a single mother of two, on welfare, you know, struggling with addiction. So I don't know really what's attractive about that, other than I can, I'm a decent cook, so I knew that, that helped. But the Lord had a plan. The Lord had a plan, and so Michael came in, and he and I struggled our way for a little while. And once again, neither one of us had still encountered the Lord. We got married soon after, and my husband, because of his own, you know, things in his life that needed Jesus' touch. He was carrying pain. He was carrying anger and rejection and pain. So those things came back up again, and when they came back up, it triggered me back into the alcohol addiction. If you know anything about addiction, when you go back, you pick off right where you left off. So it's a full force thing. So that happened, and within a really short amount of time, everything unraveled. The addiction took over me, and all of the voices that came back from early childhood, they came back with a vengeance. And I was listening. So I destroyed everything in my path at that time because I was caught up in listening to the enemy. God destroyed everything. And my husband at the time, here's where it starts to turn a little. He had everybody in his life that he knew, and even our families said, get rid of her. You know, she's garbage. You need to just let go and move on. And the Lord sent a man to my husband at his workplace who is a Christian. And praise God, yeah. And initially there was a bit of tension there because he was taking the management role that Michael wanted, so there was a bit of like like this there. But this man, Alan Dwyer, who we love, who's so dear to us, said to Michael, tie a knot at the end of your rope and don't let go until I tell you. So the Lord, in all of that, sent one man, you know, to speak faith, to speak love, to speak endurance and perseverance into my husband. And I was so completely assured that nobody could love me through what I had done. Like you guys, it just, I destroyed everything, like every relationship, every... So Michael listened, and during what I call my like MIA season, missing in action season, because I'd be gone for weeks at ends, God sent someone to hold him tight and introduced Jesus to him. And Michael gets saved and baptized. Yeah. And after that, we became part of a church that introduced us to the Lord, and we became part of a church plant. And shortly after that, I gave my life to Jesus and got baptized. And we started walking with this church for about 4 years, and it was wonderful. They taught us a lot about community and discipleship, and that season ended, and we were part of another church for a short period of time, right before COVID. And I remember during that season just being really, really hungry. Like, I know that when we come to the house of the Lord on Sundays, we come to encounter him, but I was just, during the week, I was so, like, hungry. I was just feeding myself everywhere. And one of the gentlemen that the Lord put in my path to kind of be a shepherd to me at that time from afar was a man named Carter Conlin, who was the lead pastor at the time for Times Square Church. Y'all probably recognize the story, the cross and the switchblade, and yeah, so he took over from David Wilkerson. Anyway, so I was like, had a year of just feeding myself so much from this man. I remember listening to his testimony, and he talked about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He talked about, like, the book of Acts, when the Spirit fell upon him and filled him with power and gave him his prayer language. And I was like, why is no one talking about this? Because for me, it was like, we need this. Like, we need to be empowered. We need that, like, extension cord to heaven, you know, to be empowered by him. And anyway, so I set my heart to pursue that. And not knowing at the time, I could simply just ask for it and receive. And so in my own, this is kind of funny looking back, in my own ignorance, I spent almost a year sitting in my car saying, Lord, I want this. Why aren't you giving it to me? Like, weeping and crying for it when all I could have done was just received it. So one day he sent a dear friend of mine to my house, and I shared that, and she simply came over and prayed over me, and I received my prayer language. And that was a turning point for me, because my hunger just exploded. It exploded. And we decided at that time to open our house as a home church right during COVID. We were like, we don't know what we're doing, but you know what? We have this. We're going to open, like, the book of Acts. We're just going to let the Spirit lead us and teach us what to do and listen and be obedient and respond. So it was 2 years of really just making room to do that, like just showing up and entering into worship. And what he really did was show us each of our gifts. He taught us about deliverance. We learned how to prophesy over one another. And it was really just like a small demonstration, you know, in our own home of what his kingdom looks like. And during this time, one of the things that he really ignited in us, one of the key parts that he wanted to teach us about, was about identity. And Jody knows this is my passion of my heart. It's something that just it lights a fire in me. So we were learning about false identities, and we were learning about our true identity. So an example of your false identity would be, do you hear voices talk to you and say you're worthless, or you're not good enough, or you're never gonna make it, or just give up? Those are false identities. Those are things that the enemy would speak over you. But when the Lord speaks over you, he doesn't talk like that. He wants to finely tune us to hear his voice. And so what he did for me personally was he revealed parts of my identity that I'm exploring with him. And there were four things that he gave me. And it was, he called me a kingdom surveyor, a lover of the lost, a gatherer, and a peacemaker. So now I'm going through his word and exploring, you know, what those things are in terms of my relationship with him. But I'll tell you what it really, gave birth to me in that season was, I look at people differently now. I look at every single person and I'm like, Lord, who did you make that person to be? Who are they? Like, what kind of gold is in them? You know, because you are never, ever going to look into the eyes of somebody that God doesn't have a plan for. Never. I think me growing up, I kind of had a demonstration of me, it's us against them, you know, and that's not how God sees people. He doesn't do that. He has a plan for everyone. And so now I look at people that way, and I'm looking at all of you thinking, I just see gold in everybody. I see gemstones, and I see the wonder of the Lord and the invitation to have an adventure with him. You know, this life is an adventure. It's an adventure. He didn't, you know, pay the entire price needed just so we can sit and be discouraged and wallow. The kingdom of God is at hand. It is within you. It's an internal search first with him, but everything is available. There's not one thing lacking. And so you and I get to decide to step into that by faith and start exploring with him. So look, I mean, you guys, what I shared from taking someone who was literally like an explosion of what the enemy wanted me to be, and the Lord has restored me to a place where I'm so excited, and I could never have done it. I could never have imagined this for myself. But I speak that over everyone here. Every single one of you is so unique. There's nobody like you anywhere, nor will there ever be. Ever. Ever. There's only one of you. And there's something that each of you is to do in his kingdom that nobody else can do. And I'll tell you this too, when you pursue your faith, when you pursue your destiny in the Lord, you bring others with you. There's a momentum that comes when you pursue the legacy that Jesus has for you. You will pull people into it because people are tied to your destiny. So I think I'd just like to end with just praying for everybody here and thanking the Lord for this. Heavenly Father, you are majestic and amazing. Lord, there is no one like you. There is no one like you. Even I read just this morning on the way here, Christianity, the kingdom of God is the only place that where God is a father. Lord, I pray for every heart here. We speak against rejection and abandonment. We speak against the orphan spirit, Lord. We speak against spirits of fear and anxiety and discouragement. Lord, we speak against spirits that would tell us that we're too old, that nothing good can happen at this point. Lord, that we've made too many mistakes. Father, we bind every one of those spirits in Jesus' name, and we loose the kingdom of heaven over this people and this church and this city and this nation, Lord. And I thank you, Father, that you love us, but you want to adventure with us, Lord. You want to adventure with us. You are supernatural. That's your natural. So I pray this year, Father, that every heart in this room and those listening online would sit before you with a pen and a paper, because I think that causes expectancy, and just ask you the question, Lord, who do you say I am? Who am I? What do you call me? And I thank you, Lord, that you will answer them. You are a God that speaks. You're not a God of confusion. You are invested in every single person's destiny. You are zealous for the word that you've put in each person. So I thank you, and I prophesy that every single person here will not miss one iota of their destiny. They will walk it out in the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. And I speak over even Oxford as a community and a town, Lord, that you would light a fire here by your Holy Spirit. Light a fire in people, Lord. Start revivals in individuals and let them light each other on fire. I thank you, Lord, that you do these things, that it's just a surrendering and a yielding of our heart, and you do it with us. We're never alone. I thank you that you're fun. I thank you that you're filled with wonder. And I thank you for friends like Jody, who do such an amazing job of leading with integrity, sharing her gifts in a way that just people are changed by them, Lord. That's what her gifts are for. They're not for us, they're for other people. So I pray that every person would recognize the gift that they are and the gift that they carry, and they would start to practice it with your leading, and that there would be an exponential growth of fruit in this church and in this city, Lord. In Jesus' name, we thank you. We thank you in Jesus' name. That's it, you guys. I didn't even cry. That's a lot. That's good. That's good.
Thank you so much to each of them. You know, I want to share you a verse the Lord brought to my mind. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach. So I know it's time for everybody's bellies to be filled. When I was reading the Samaritan woman story, I kept going this morning. And after it says, many Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony, it goes on to say that they said, we don't longer believe because of what you said, but we now have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior. So it starts with a testimony. Somebody hears, and then they can find out for themselves. Now I know, but thanks for leading me there. I want to challenge you all this week, if you're up for a little test, I want to challenge you to get into the book of Acts this week. Read chapters maybe 4, 5, 6 there. I started to notice the power of testimony, because when Jesus was resurrected, what did they try to do? Shut down the testimony. Read it. Over and over, it will tell you that it says in 4, warn them not to speak. Tell them not to speak. Stop them from speaking. And then what did these believers do? Lord, enable us to speak boldly. And signs and wonders came. And then they said, don't speak. And it says, with great power, the apostles continued to testify. And then you go on, they testified. Go and testify about the new life. I want to encourage you today to think about the power of your story. Their stories just point us, you know, to some truth. But what about your own story? We all have a little bit of a journey that is meant to share with someone else. They impacted me today. They shared with us some truth, but here's your challenge. Read it and go out and share your story with someone this week. Many believed because of their testimony. Have you shared yours? Have you shared with someone? Come on over for coffee. I was thinking about my journey. I want to share it with you, my friend. I would love to challenge you to do that and tell me how that goes. Because many believe because of the testimony. What's your story? Let's sing in closing together. We're going to sing Who You Say I Am. All right. Why don't you stand with us? We'll sing about our identity. Thank you, Tracy, for sharing that with us today.
Love for
amen, and I challenge you again in your prayer time this week, ask God, who do you say I am? Who do you say that I am? Tracy has challenged me to explore those questions, and ooh, what God has told me is good, is good. Ask him, who do you say I am? Let me send you with this blessing today. Paul said to the Ephesians, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. God bless you today.